conversation with Paul Raymond from ConfirmaPay. So, Paul, thank you for joining us this morning.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the opportunity.
That's a pleasure. Which of the travel management components which comprise a corporate travel strategy have you decided to focus on today?
As you might expect, I want to talk about payment.
That is a surprise.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
And what is it in particular about? I mean, it's a massive subject. Mm. It's obviously fundamental to every program. So what particular aspects?
So I think a couple of things. Firstly, the wider aspects of payments. So how payments becoming a much more focus for the travel industry, as it should be and as it should have been for a long time.
You sense that across not just the buyers, intermediaries as well?
Yeah, and okay. I think what we're beginning to see is practices that have been operated in certain areas of the travel industry coming into the managed travel industry, which I think is probably the least evolved in terms of payment and in terms of using payment to its best capabilities.
Okay, so do you mean by that it works pretty well in a B2C environment, but in B2B something happens that means it's not as frictionless as it should be? It's
certainly in the travel industry, B2B. Okay. I mean, B2B payment now is such a high focus for every other industry. So you look at things like Coupa, SAP Ariba, all of those organizations are maximizing the use of payments and maximizing the use of the payment schemes, Visa, MasterCard, to make sure that the payment efficiencies are there and also that there are financials that meet the requirements at both ends. The travel industry hasn't done that and is slow to pick up on that.
Okay. It's always, for me, as sort of a pure travel guy, mm-hmm. I'm always so confused by payments. Yep. There's like so many layers to it.
Sure.
And it is a separate industry in its own right, yep. Right? But I almost want it to go away. I don't even want to know that it's happened.
Yeah.
And I feel like we're a long way off from that position, but maybe you see developments occurring, which I don't.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of things there, because I think we've got an underused network, which is the card scheme network. So MasterCard, Visa, American Express, for a long time really have been underutilized. So if you actually look at their share prices now, there's a recognition that actually the value that they can offer to the global industry is going to be growing.
Okay.
And therefore, we should, as a travel industry, take advantage of that. They've got the technology, they've got the efficiencies. What we need to do is to start to utilize that by adapting our product sets and adapting our processes to take advantage of those benefits.
Okay.
So I think from a ConfirmaPay point of view, what we've tried to do is look at a number of levels. So to try and sort of break out the confusion that you're talking about, there's the scheme level. So those are the guys who are essentially offering the technology to the banking partners.
Right.
Then you've got the banking partners who are the guys who are actually banking you, issuing cards, lending you money, or creating accounts that you can draw cash into and deposit cash into. And then you've got the systems that operate below them where you need to integrate that payment vehicle, make sure it's accepted by the merchant, make sure it can actually be billed, and then deliver the payment reconciliation to you as a travel manager or as a travel organization at the back end. And it's sort of quite simple, but the challenge has always been that it sort of stopped at the banks. So the banks were quite happy to proliferate giving physical pieces of plastic to a limited number of people. And then everybody else had to sort their own plans out.
Yeah.
What we're trying to do is democratize payment. So basically put a payment vehicle that will work for a traveler in the hands of that traveler. And typically that's going to be via some form of mobile device or some form of embedded payment. So if you look at the Uber moment, which I think we talked about before, what we're saying there is that actually, as you say, you don't think about payment.
No.
It's there. And if I'm arriving in New York or if I'm arriving in London, the payment experience is exactly the same, i.e. I know what I've got to pay and I see a reconciled bill at the end of it and I'm really not worried about it at all.
No.
That's what we need the travel experience to be like for every aspect of travel.
And one of the biggest demands that I see from the corporate is virtual pay for hotels.
Yeah.
And it feels like it's got stuck somewhere. Mm. Any perspectives on why? And
I think the hotel industry is the most complex, particularly in Europe, where we've got this fragmented situation where there's so many brands. It's not like in the States where you've got the primary brands that typically look after the larger number of properties. I think it's something like, in the States, it's something like 70-30 a brand.
Yeah.
And in Europe and the rest of the world, it's pretty much the reverse of that. So what you've got is a number of systems, you've got a number of access points, you've got a number of disparate points where you've got to try and get the payment process to be consistent. And because of that, people have come up with niche ways of dealing with things. You'll have different products in different countries. You'll have a lot of reliance on what was traditional invoice. So you've got to, first of all, look at why those systems have grown up and those processes have grown up. Then you've got to say, well, okay, can we replace them with a card-based consistent system?
Yeah.
And then you've got to do it.
Yes, yeah, and that's the big piece,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And there's got to be a reason to do it, because if I'm going to ask you to do some work, you're going to say to me, well, what's in it for me?
Yeah.
And if all I can say to you is, it's a better process,
yes,
you're going to go, well, that's what everybody's telling me. So it's either got to be financial, it's got to be security, or it's got to be client-driven.
Yes.
And ideally, it's all three of those things. So I think we're beginning to see it. The other thing that I think everybody's going to be able to take advantage of, going back to the point I was making earlier, is mobile. So as NFC tap-and-go capabilities grow, then you're going to see the capability to actually deliver a corporate virtual card to the point of sale and make it easy to bill globally accessible. Best example I can give you of that is the US, where for years everybody had to sign it when they put a card in. And everyone was saying, oh, chip and pin, chip and pin, chip,
yes,
and pin. Chip and pin never happened in the States.
No, it hasn't.
They've jumped straight to NFC.
Yeah, okay.
So the card providers are basically saying, that's what people will do.
Yeah.
When I've got to do this, I might as well get cash out. So once I've got the ability to do that, and I can proliferate that across everywhere, because I can collect the data, I can make it some more secure, I can use the biometrics on the phone, whatever it may be, to reduce the cost of fraud, then it's in my interest to do it.
Yes.
And then it starts to be in the interest of the merchant, because if you're saying, well, if you've got to accept traditionally and signature, which I know is not secure, as opposed to a secure biometric system, well, I'm going to pay you, or it's going to cost me less for you to actually accept a card doing it that way than it does it through the traditional one.
It seems like within travel programs that procurement's gone to a certain point, and now it's really tiny increments they can make.
Absolutely.
And actually focusing on areas like payment could be where you start to create a lot more efficiency. And with the hotel piece, I mean, I remember talking to one of the hotel booking tools and saying, wouldn't it be great if when you negotiate with your hotels, there's a virtual payment solution involved,
yep,
and on the booking tool, maybe there's a little V or something that shows that virtual payment's available, and that's part of the procurement process.
Absolutely.
And then you drive traffic towards virtual payment solutions.
Yep.
Do you think, does the travel manager have to get closer to finance within their own business to make this stuff work better as well?
I think so. I think one of the challenges, and you know, no disrespect to you, that question you're asking me and saying, oh, well, payment.
Yeah.
I think everybody should take the time to educate themselves,
yes, okay,
on where payment fits into.
I feel like I've been told off.
Well, you have been told.
Okay.
For years I've been talking to you about this.
I'm going to learn. Okay.
But I think it's so important because you know the travel process,
yes,
better than the finance people know the travel process.
Yes.
And they know the finance process better than they know the travel piece.
Yes.
So if you can bring those two things together and say, well, actually, if we do this or change that or make this better, A, we can save ourselves some money. B, we can take away some of the pain that's existing in the business. And C, we can work better with our merchants. If you can drive traffic through the preferred method of payment and you make that form of payment ubiquitous across all your travel network, then surely that's got to be something that's of value to you in the finance department and value to you in the travel department, where you can collect all that data.
Yeah.
Again, you know, talking about Uber, we're now looking at ground transportation as the next thing that's going to be of real interest. So we've been working with iGo on the AutoCab platform.
Yeah.
And basically what they're doing is they're going to integrate our virtual payment platform to allow all of our 45 banks to flow virtual payments into their car network. So from a traveler's point of view, that will mean essentially I can book my hotel using a virtual card. I can book my air using a virtual card. But then for the same account, I can then book my travel to and from the airport. And I'm starting to capture my true trip process.
Yes, the whole lot end to end, right?
And you're doing it through payment. And then the extension of that is to say, well, actually, I can start to catch the authorization information. So if you're looking now in your personal card, you're on Barclay card or whatever it may be, and you start to see authorizations coming through on your phone, saying, oh, yes, well, that was at Starbucks. Can you imagine the same thing on your corporate card?
Yes.
So if you can now say, okay, I know my hotel, I know my air's been billed, I know now Joe's traveling to Japan, and they've landed, and their card's been authorized, so I know they're safe. More importantly,
yes,
I know that they're staying in Marbella, and there's been some form of challenge for that travel. I need to contact them. But I know that they're actually there because physically they've actually authorized that card, and through the banking network, I know where they are.
So it's like a base layer that allows you to focus on other value areas within
Absolutely.
Travel.
Absolutely. It's information at point of sale that previously we haven't been able to get. It's come from the retail arm, but again, it goes to the point here, which is how is managed travel going to take advantage of these things? Instead of worrying about, you know, another basis point off the airline or 1% off the cost of a ticket, start to think on a wider base and say, well, actually, what's the total cost of that trip?
Yes.
So it may look like £100 in a hotel, and it may look like £200 in a flight, but actually you've got 50 quid in a cab.
Yes.
You've got another bag, which has cost me £26. You've got 15 coffees because I've got to pay for everybody.
Yes.
And I'm not capturing any of that until post-trip. If you can bring it all together through the payment vehicle, what you can start to do is say, well, actually, I can enforce policy or work with policy or develop a policy that means my travellers are able to take advantage of the deals that I'm able to do.
Just before we get to the last bit about what you think travel managers need to think about, we did a project called Mission Cashless.
Yes.
With our own Auralee Crowe.
Absolutely.
Going around the world testing virtual payments.
Yep.
What's your prediction on the uptake of virtual payments? We're all waiting for it, you know, mass scale. When are we going to start to see that mass market adoption?
So I think probably the last frontier is managed travel.
Okay.
Because if you think about now the mobile experience that you have in your personal life, I think we need to see that proliferated into the corporate space. And that is starting to be done. So our mobile application actually has the ability now to deploy a virtual card into an Apple Pay wallet, into a Google Pay wallet, and we can do that from any one of our 45 banking partners. That will continue to expand, but the merchants then have to get on board with that. So these guys have to work out what's best for them. So again, you know, if we're talking to a hotel, ideally you want them to be able to accept an NFC payment. You want them to walk in, tap your phone, and go to your room.
Yeah.
And the payment's done.
Yeah.
So that's the way we need to look at these things. Not what's my system at the moment and how can I make that system work? You need to say, well, forget your system at the moment.
Yeah.
What do you want? What's the optimal solution that you got here? So going back to your question about virtual payment, I think it's already happening.
Okay.
I think it's happening. And I think what you're going to see more and more is people saying, well, how can I get that virtual payment piece across the wider travel program that I've got?
Okay. And advice to buyers in the next 12, 24 months when it comes to payment, what should they be focusing on?
Two things. Bit of homework, a la you.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Understand what your banking partner, your preferred banking partner, can offer. Understand what the benefits may or may not be to your business. Take a look at any areas of the business where utilizing virtual payment or mobile payment can actually add value, and then say, just think out of the box. Say, well, actually, I'd like it to do this. Can it do this?
Yes.
And I guarantee your bank will say, they'll either say yes or they'll say, not just yet, but
in
6 months. We'll keep it at the front of our memory. And then the other thing is to try. So start looking at ways in which you can maybe pilot things within your business.
Get small user groups.
Absolutely. Get people used to, don't say to them, right, how many people use Apple Pay in the business today? And I guarantee it'll be 50%.
Yeah.
Say it's the other 50%. If you've got an iPhone, just start using it.
Yeah.
Tell me what your experience is. Tell me where we might be able to apply that into our wider travel network.
Right.
See what we can do, and then we can actually and a learned behavior you can apply to manage business travel.
I love it. So there's two challenges to the industry.
Absolutely.
One is learn more. Second one is do pilots and try and test and learn.
Definitely.
Which is brilliant. Paul, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
And I hope you have a great show.
Thank you very much.